Thank you. The next item of business is a statement by Mary McCallan on A9 duelling programme. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement and hence there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Mary McCallan, Cabinet Secretary, up to 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, thank you very much. Following the Deputy First Minister's budget statement yesterday, I'm very pleased to have the chance to provide more detail on completing the duelling of the A9 between Perth and Inverness. Now, I know that this statement is keenly anticipated, especially by those who are concerned to see safety improvements developed on the A9 and for the many Scottish communities and businesses for whom the A9 is essential. I am, Presiding Officer, acutely aware of the strength of feeling on this issue. This programme has faced challenges, and I acknowledge that it has not progressed at the pace we would have liked. There have, of course, been particular challenges with sky-high inflation causing slippage in major capital projects. However, the A9 is the backbone of Scotland. It must be safe, it must be reliable, it must be resilient, and that is what this government will deliver. When I assumed responsibility for Transport and Cabinet in June, my primary objectives for the A9 project were threefold. Firstly, to oversee amendments to Transport Scotland's approach to procurement of its design and build contracts, to improve prospects and to avoid a repeat of last year's experiences with the section between Tamatan and Moy. Secondly, to finalise a delivery plan for duelling the remaining sections of the programme, which foregrounded certainty of delivery, but also carefully balanced this against considerations of market capacity, affordability and the need to minimise disruption on the network. And finally, in the meantime, to progress interim safety interventions short of and in anticipation of duelling. And I'll address each of these issues today. While focusing my remarks principally on the remainder of the programme, a word first on Tamatan to Moy. Following the outcome of the first procurement for the section, Transport Scotland undertook extensive market consultation with the construction industry in order to gather views on how its major roads projects could generate improved tender competition. As a result of this engagement, the new engineering contract with amendments was adopted for use on a new procurement for Tamatan to Moy. This change in contracting approach was welcomed by the Civil Engineering Contractors Association. The new engineering contract is preferred by the industry and is widely used across the UK, with the terms and conditions adopted by Transport Scotland now offering a more balanced approach to the sharing of risk between Scottish ministers and those with whom we contract. And I can confirm that on 11th December this year, invitations to participate in dialogue were issued to three shortlisted contractors, and it's expected that award of this contract will take place in early summer 2024, with the completed duelling expected to be operational by the end of 2027. Meanwhile, the Scottish Government has been determinedly considering procurement options for duelling the remaining eight sections. Options considered include procuring all projects using either a design and build contract or a mutual investment model known as MIM, used by the Welsh Government, and a public-private partnership contract, or indeed, we considered a hybrid of both approaches. We've also considered carefully how works are sequenced to provide an efficient overall programme that's aligned with the market's capacity to deliver, which minimises disruption to road users, and which is achievable within the wider financial constraints. And of course, as the Deputy First Minister outlined yesterday, the UK, having not inflation-proofed their capital budget, has left us with a nearly 10% real terms cut in our capital funding between 23-24 and 27-28. So, Presiding Officer, this has been a complex exercise, but the Government has concluded that the hybrid approach is the best way to complete the A9 duelling programme. And I can therefore confirm that the Government will progress the three remaining A9 duelling projects at the southern end of the route via three capital-funded design and build contracts. We then anticipate progressing the five remaining projects in the north and central stretches via two resource-funded MIM contracts. That's subject to ongoing due diligence and further decision-making in late 2025 and will be based on an updated assessment of expected market conditions. And I can confirm today that in progression of this delivery plan, work will begin immediately on preparations for the procurement for the next design and build contract, which will be for the Tay Crossing to Ballinlough project, with the contract notice planned for publication in spring 2024, and award anticipated in summer 25. In addition, procurement of the Pitlochry to Killiecrankie project and subject to completion of statutory processes, the Pass of Burnham to Tay Crossing will commence in summer 25 and summer 27 respectively. Then, subject to decision-making in late 25, procurement for the two remaining northern projects under a single MIM contract could then commence in winter 26-27, with the second MIM contract comprising the remaining three central projects commencing procurement in 28-29. This hybrid approach, Presiding Officer, will create a rolling programme of construction which will lead to the progressive opening of the dualled sections. Under this new plan, by the end of 2030, we anticipate that nearly 50% of the A9 will be dualled, will be open as dualled carriageway, rising to 85% by the end of 2033 and eventually 100% by the end of 2035. This means we will see significant benefits from the dualling programme years ahead of that backstop in 2035. And I should say we have published all of the details of this programme on our Transport Scotland website today. Now, as part of our work, we have also prepared updated scheme cost estimates for each project. The total cost of the programme is now estimated at £3.7 billion at April 23 prices. Now, when adjusted for inflation, that's equivalent to £2.45 billion at April 2008 prices, which the Chamber will note is well within the original cost estimate of £3 billion at 2008 prices. Now, Presiding Officer, that's cost. I want to talk about safety. The improved safety expected from dualling is absolutely crucial. I wish to take this opportunity to offer my heartfelt sympathies and my condolences to anyone who's lost a loved one or indeed who has been injured in collisions on the A9. Dualling will see driver stress and accidents reduced. Likewise, the severity and journey times for emergency vehicles will also be reduced. Dualling offers resilience, limiting the need for lengthy diversions. At the same time, the A9 is critical to the movements of freight, business and leisure travellers. Dualling improves reliability and the average times of journeys by 20%. This is transformative for a route that offers 35%, that serves 35% of our landmass and carries around 10% of Scotland's GDP in terms of cargo. Investment in the route will help grow the economy, but the impact is wider than economic. The A9 is the backbone that connects Central and Highland Scotland, and for the 10,000 people living along it, it is often the only connection to vital services. It will also maximise the range of opportunities for contractors and their long supply chains. Presiding Officer, this programme will ensure that the link between two of Scotland's great cities is safe and fit for purpose for everyone who needs to use it, both now and in the future. Comprehensive stakeholder engagement on this plan will begin early in the new year, building on extensive engagement to date. I will today write to interested MSPs, inviting them to a briefing in Parliament as a first step. Regular engagement will continue as the programme progresses, including, of course, with local communities and on their individual projects. In the meantime, anyone with an interest in the A9 can sign up for updates at www.a9dualling.scot prior to the full launch of a new A9 dualling website early in the new year. And we will also advertise engagement opportunities here and through traditional and social media. Presiding Officer, decisions to complete the statutory processes are now complete for over 92% of the programme. We will complete the statutory processes for the three outstanding schemes with ministerial consent next year and will acquire the necessary land to support the procurement timetable. The only project not to have yet started that process is the Pass of Burnham to Tay Crossing. I'd like to take the chance to thank the local community for their valuable input through the creative process. And today I can announce that the preferred route for this section is confirmed and that it includes a number of the elements of the community's preferred options, including a roundabout at Dunkeld and the junction layouts at the Hermitage and Dalgees. Further details of the preferred route, like the programme itself, are available on Transport Scotland's website, and local communities and road users will have the opportunity to comment on the plans at public exhibitions in January. In the time I have left, Presiding Officer, I'd like to say a word on safety before concluding. Having updated on Tamat and Tamoy and the remainder of the programme, I just want to close with safety because since 2007, this government has invested £300 million in the maintenance and safety of the A9 and a further £3.6 million on average speed cameras. Following the tragic loss of life that occurred on the route in particular in 2022, we've been investing an additional approximate £5 million, and I'm pleased to confirm that those safety measures are progressing at pace, with a number of elements completed. And of course, these include enhancements to signing and road markings, emphasis at junctions, and those vital transitions between dual and single carriageways. And as with the rest of the trunk road network, presiding officer, the safety performance of the A9 will continue to be regularly reviewed. Time is against me, but to conclude, this government is restating its commitment today to dualling the A9 between Perth and Inverness, and we're doing that with a concrete plan. The approach that I have set out means that the Highlands can have confidence that the considerable benefits of the A9 dualling programme will be delivered and in full. Now that we have reached this point, presiding officer, there will be no let-up. When construction starts on Tamatin-Tamoy next year, under this delivery programme, it will roll continually until the route between Perth and Inverness is fully dualled. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which time we will move on to the next item of business. And it would be helpful if those members who would wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons. And I call Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement? Although we have been waiting for this update since February, and here we are on the second last sitting day of the year. But our wait here is as nothing compared to the wait of the people of Perth and Kinross and the Highlands and Islands, who have been waiting for years to see this vital project completed, with an SNP government in power who have delivered a mere 11 miles of dual carriageway in 16 years. And throughout that period, too many lives have needlessly been lost, and more will die as a result of the delays we have heard about today. At best, we will be waiting another 12 years for this project to be completed, and that is the most optimistic outcome we can hope for. Now, the Cabinet Secretary did her best to deflect criticism onto the UK government, but I would gently remind her that if the SNP had kept their promise to complete the dualling by 2025, then the challenges she identifies with inflation and her government's capital budget would not have been an issue. Now, today, Presiding Officer, we were expecting to hear that a contract had been placed for the Tamatin to Moy section. Even that has not been delivered. Instead, the best we have is an expectation that there will be a contract award in summer next year. So 1 year on from where we were at the start of this year, we are precisely no further forward. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary three things? Firstly, what guarantees can she give us that this contract award for Tamatin to Moy will now actually be done and on the timescale she has outlined, given all the slippage in timescales we've seen in the past? Secondly, in relation to the remaining sections, what confidence can we have that the timescales set out today are actually deliverable, even supposing that the funding can be found? And thirdly, how confident is the Minister that there is appropriate civil engineering contracting capacity to carry out these works? And what discussions has she held with industry to determine their willingness to tender for the contracts that are being proposed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I thank Murdo Fraser for his question, and I should like to begin by acknowledging his point about a delay in my update. I had hoped to give this update some weeks ago, and I am always seeking to expedite progress in this regard. Unfortunately, the A9 dualling project is a complex project. Indeed, it's actually 11 complex projects, but as of today, it is a complex project with a comprehensive delivery plan, and I hope that even Murdo Fraser can welcome that. I think the critical theme in all of the points that he raises is about certainty, Presiding Officer. Certainty as regards to Tamatin to Moy, certainty as regards the remainder of the programme. The plan that we've set out today has sought to foreground certainty of delivery. But as I said in my statement, we have carefully balanced that with the other factors that we must consider, namely the need to minimise disruption, market capacity, and, of course, affordability. So with all of that taken into account, what we're publishing today provides the greatest certainty that I am able to provide bearing in mind that this is a large project with significant complexities, significant interdependencies, all of which are actually susceptible to a variety of external factors, not least the financial volatility that we have become so accustomed to under Murdo Fraser's government.
I call Alec Riley.
Presiding Officer, the SNP first committed to dual the A9 back in 2007. Today, 16 years on, and excuse after excuse after excuse later, the Cabinet Secretary expects us to be happy that by 2030, 23 years after the 2007 commitment, they will have completed less than 50% of this project. With a new date of 2035 for completion between Perth and Inverness, some 28 years after the initial promise, one has to wonder how on earth can the Cabinet Secretary say with a straight face that the Highlands can have confidence that the A9 dual-in programme will be delivered and in full. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does she have the confidence that this government is even capable of delivering infrastructure projects of this scale?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, this government has got a proud history of delivering major projects. Yeah, absolutely. There are a plethora of major projects, and I have absolute confidence, but I'm not complacent at the same time, and that's why we have spent time. And as I set out since I had responsibility for this, I've been determined to spend time finding all the ways possible to increase certainty in this project. That has involved updating our business case. It has involved spending considerable time, and Transport Scotland spending considerable time, engaging with the industry to update our approach to contraction, to contracting under design and build contracts. And it has all brought together this new plan, which for the first time anticipates using a hybrid model of funding options that are available. So this is an example of the government using every tool at its disposal and working exceptionally hard to give the confidence to the Highlands and to everyone who I accept have been waiting too long that this will be completed, and as I say, Presiding Officer, on a rolling basis of construction with 50% completed by 2030, 85% by 2033 and 100% dualling by the end of 2035.
I call John Swinney to be followed by Jamie Hilker-Johnson.
Presiding Officer, in welcoming the reaffirmation of the Government's commitment to dual the A9, which builds on the successful completion of a range of capital projects, including the Queensferry Crossing, the M74 completion, the M8 completion, the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route completion, the Airdrie to Bathgate Railway and the Borders Railway, and the acceptance by the Cabinet Secretary of a number of the proposals made by my constituents in the Dunkeld and Burnham area regarding the design of the route at that particularly challenging site. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree to further engagement from herself, the Transport Minister and their officials with community groups in Dunkeld and Burnham about the design issues and also, crucially, on short-term improvements that could be made to road safety in advance of the dualling works being undertaken?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Mr Swinney for so eloquently reeling off the plethora of major projects that this Government can be very proud for having delivered. On the point about his locality, I would like to thank the Burnham to Ballinu A9 Community Group for its work in working with us in a co-creative process which has helped to broaden our vision for the A9 dualling project through this really important route. The Transport Minister and I truly value the input that they have made to the process. And building on the positive relationship that's been established, I should like to reassure Mr Swinney that we will continue to engage with him, with his local community, and all of that as we continue to develop this section of the A9, which of course has taken a big step forward today. Indeed, I can advise that Transport Scotland officials are meeting the Burnham to Ballinlough A9 community group later this afternoon to discuss that preferred route option. And of course, as I mentioned in my statement, we will be holding those public exhibitions locally in January for the community.
I call Jamie Hilker-Johnson to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Time and time again, SNP ministers have come to this chamber, appeared in front of committees or pledged in public that the A9 would be dualled in full between Inverness and Perth and by the promised 2025 date. That was despite all evidence being to the contrary. We now know that since 2018 they were not being honest. The Scottish Government knew because officials told them that the 2025 date was unachievable. But it wasn't until last year, nearly 5 years later, that SNP ministers finally came clean. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, how can local businesses, those who live along the route of the A9 and those who've lost loved ones on the road, trust this government to finally deliver on these new, even more vague promises when they've been lied to so many times before?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm not sure that that was parliamentary language, but that is entirely your decision to adjudicate on.
Cabinet Secretary, please resume your seat. I heard what the member said and I noted carefully in the way in which he phrased it. It is, of course, absolutely unacceptable to refer to another member as having lied or being untruthful. I felt that the way in which it was phrased didn't quite fall within that bracket, and indeed it would be for me in the chair. Thank you.
Said it's for you to adjudicate on. The member's question centred on the inquiry that the Public Petitions Committee are currently undertaking, which is a retrospective look on the progress of the programme to date. I'm concerned that my statement today is about looking forward, but I have agreed to appear in front of the Public Petitions Committee to assist them in their important inquiry. And indeed, some of the documents that Mr Halcrow-Johnson referred to are part of the very many that the Scottish Government have handed over to the inquiry. I think Mr Halcrow-Johnson will find he'll have to correct the record at some point in the future. It was not, and the papers make this entirely clear, and I will certainly reiterate at committee, it was not until late 2022 that Transport Scotland knew for certain that the 2025 date was not deliverable. And a number of the papers that Mr Halcrow-Johnson is speaking to talk, for example, about moving only to a MIM model and the deliverability of that by 2025. They did not mention capital design and build. So, as I say, I'm happy to appear in front of the committee and discuss these matters on the retrospective account. I'm looking forward today with this optimum delivery plan.
I call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you. Can the Cabinet Secretary say a bit more about the mutual investment model that she referenced in her statement, what it entails and what the advantages of it are?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, absolutely. I'm happy to. The mutual investment model, as I said in my statement, is one that has been developed and used by the Welsh Government. It's a form of public-private partnership which is similar in many respects to non-profit distributing contract, which was previously used in a number of major road projects, including some of those that Mr Swinney narrated. Now, the principal advantages that such a contract offers is that it provides additionality of investment through the use of private finance to deliver infrastructure projects and reduces the level of annual expenditure by spreading payments over a longer period of time. It does, however, represent a significant long-term financial commitment and requires a detailed consideration of market conditions, and especially inflation and the cost of borrowing. And that's why we, in a prudent manner, have built in decision-making points within this programme where we will consider how appropriate it is to move to a MIM, given prevailing market conditions at the time.
I call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer, the announcement that one section will be duelled in the next 4 years is not going to pacify the anger of my constituents due to the lack of progress. The Government knew it was not going to meet its 2025 promise, yet tried to hide that. Can I ask if she will give detail as to the key differences between design and build and mutual investment models and where the risk for each lies? And will she tell my constituents how they can realistically gauge progress towards completion for themselves, given the Government's deception in the past?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I hope that the member was listening to my response to Jamie Halcrow-Johnson when I made absolutely clear that it was not until 2022 that Transport Scotland knew for sure that 2025 was not achievable. And Scottish ministers updated the Parliament shortly thereafter. And I think that Rhoda Grant, in referring to one section being completed in the coming years, is missing the point that I've been trying to stress, which is that this is a 12-year programme, but one of rolling construction, so that when spades are in the ground for Tomaten and Tamoy section next summer, we will see rolling construction right through to 2035. And as I say, with that progressive opening, 50% by the end of 2030, 85% of 2033, and 100% by the end of 2035, so that people who I accept rely on this route so fundamentally can enjoy the safety and economic and other benefits that come from duelling in advance of the completion of the entire programme.
I call Fergus Ewing, followed by Beatrice Wishart.
Presiding Officer, on the way to the chamber this afternoon, and quite by chance, I bumped into an Invernessian who reminded me that he had lost friends on the A9. And that was a salutary reminder of the force behind this campaign. Presiding Officer, in any campaign, it's wise to accept victory where it occurs and to be magnanimous. And it is said that to be prepared is half the victory. And I think she will agree we're not as yet fully prepared. So will she acknowledge that many, including myself, will continue to remain sceptical until they see even the diggers on the road, and that the statement today, whilst on the face of it encouraging, involves a huge amount of work ahead? And so in conclusion, there must be no more slippage, no more delays, and no more broken promises.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I want to thank Fergus Ewing for his contribution today, but equally for his determined campaigning on this matter. Of course, since I've been in post, but long before that as well. He mentioned in his opening remarks about the loss of life, and of course that is the principal issue at the forefront of this. I attended an event with Fergus Ewing over the summer, organised by the P&J and the Inverness Courier, where we were joined by family members of the bereaved. And I can assure Fergus Ewing and the Chamber that that experience will never leave me and has been with me in all the work that we've been seeking to do as a team ever since. I wouldn't expect Fergus Ewing to be anything other than sceptical, helpfully sceptical, I hope, moving forward. But I can assure him, as I have to other members, that what we've tried to produce today is the greatest possible certainty in a fairly uncertain world. And I can assure him that whilst I can't prevent issues from arising, where they arise, the government will seek to overcome them and as quickly as possible.
I call Beatrice Wishart, who's joining us remotely, to be followed by Kate Forbes. Ms. Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yesterday we heard of another serious crash on the A9 near Invergordon, and my thoughts are with those taken to Aberdeen Royal Infirmary after the collision. But this highlights the known dangers of the A9 in its current state. And there was news last week that in 2018 it was thought that the target to dual the A9 between Inverness and Perth by 2025 was unachievable. Yet ministers didn't change course to address this, and 77 miles of the A9 are still not dualled. The new timeline will mean years of delay from the original commitment. And I must say, I'm surprised there was no apology anywhere in the Cabinet Secretary's statement about this. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what guarantees can the Scottish Government provide this time that the new dates are realistic and we will see completion by the new date?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I thank Beatrice Wishart, and I would echo to her what I have to Fergus Ewing and a number of others, which is to, I suppose, reassure her in the first instance that that certainty of delivery that she and others are seeking is what has driven the development of this plan. And whilst it would be a little foolish to suggest that in a project of this scale and this complexity that issues won't arise, of course they will, I give her the same commitment that I have given to Fergus Ewing and others, which is that when they arise, where they arise, the government will seek to address them and as quickly as possible. She's absolutely right to acknowledge the accident that occurred near Tomach this week. My sympathies and that of all my colleagues are with those who have been involved. We are awaiting further details, but I also want to thank the emergency services who were so promptly on the scene. But that relates to another part of Beatrice Wishart's question, which is about how the duelling is principally a safety issue. And I have very much at the forefront of my mind how driver stress, how driver frustration will be reduced by duelling, how the severity of accidents will be reduced by duelling, because we know it's head-on collisions which are the most difficult and fatal. And of course, emergency vehicles access will be quicker, not just where there's accidents on the road, but for the 10,000 people who live along the route.
I call Kate Forbes to be followed by Edward Binton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My declaration of interest that I probably spend about 10 hours every week on the A9. The Cabinet Secretary may recall just a matter of weeks ago that the Tories said that duelling the A9 would take a century, so I've never been more thankful that she's in charge with an updated deadline of 2035 and not them. But can I also pay tribute to the Highlanders who've waited patiently for the A9 to be duelled, and their spokespeople, not least the Inverness Courier, who are here today. Certainty Security really matters, and in order to restore trust, we have to keep communities regularly informed so that there are no surprises. How do we do that so that they can trust the pronouncements made by the government and that progress is genuinely being made?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. And I understand entirely the sentiments that Kate Forbes has expressed. My clear objective today is to set out that this is a new optimal delivery plan, and it is a concrete one, that the approach that we have set out means that people in the Highlands and those who travel there can have confidence that all of those considerable benefits of A9 dualling that we know exist will be realised and as efficiently as we can. And as I said, I will repeat, now that we have reached this point, there will be no let up. Under this plan, under this rolling delivery programme, we will see continual work, continual construction until the route is finished. And she's quite right to point out that so-called research by the Conservative Party pointed recently to this potentially taking 111 years. I hope even they will welcome the fact that it is going to take about a tenth of that time.
I call Edward Mountain to be followed by Mark Ruskin.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In the dark days of winter, we now get the promised autumn statement on the A9. I suppose better late than never, considering the time we've been waiting for this project. Considering the government's record, how can Scots believe that they can only deliver a miserable 7 miles a year of duelling to complete this project by 2035? Surely we should expect more in the fact that you failed to deliver a long-standing promise.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, again, I would just point out to Edward Mountain the irony, I suppose, that his, whilst his party were compiling what they call research, what I would call a little ridiculous, whilst they were compiling those press releases, thankfully the government, taking this serious issue very seriously, we're working hard to overcome the barriers that we need to in order to present this comprehensive plan today. And that includes, as I have said, looking closely at our business case, updating that, working with industry to improve the manner in which we procure, design and build contracts, and building this plan, which, as I've said, foregrounds certainty of delivery, but considers market capacity, considers affordability, and ensures that there will not be unmanageable disruption on the route.
And I
commend it to the Parliament. Thank you.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary has rightly highlighted safety on the A9 as being the overriding priority, and the Green Group are behind appropriate action needed to cut casualties and tragedies on the road. But given that the A9 programme won't be completed until the mid-2030s, can I ask what other options to improve safety on the A9 have been reviewed, while of course staying on track to meet our legally binding climate targets?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to Mark Ruskell for highlighting what, as I have said, is the principal driver of this work as far as the government's concerned, and that is the improvement of safety. As I mentioned in my statement, since 2007, this government has invested £300 million in the safety and maintenance of the A9 and a further £3.6 million on app for average speed cameras, which I think everybody would accept made a difference, but do not go as far as duelling itself will. In addition, following that quite marked increase in accidents that occurred during 2022, we responded with an additional £5 million in road safety measures. These have included enhancements to signing and road markings, with a particular emphasis at junctions and that transition between dual and single carriageway, which we know can be difficult. So this introduction of average speed cameras, the work of Police Scotland, targeted education campaigns and the ongoing management and maintenance of the route have helped to reduce accidents and casualties from that long-term trend that we were seeing with the exception of 2022, and that remains at the foreground of our thinking.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the statement, and apologies to those few members who I was unable to call. Point of order, Megan Gallagher.
I seek your guidance. The statement on the Scottish Government's response to the Section 35 Order Judicial Review was sent to me at 16 minutes past three this afternoon. Statements are usually sent within sufficient time that allows MSPs to read over and scrutinise the Minister's statement prior to arriving in the Chamber. Sending a statement through 4 minutes before business is scheduled is discourteous to elected members in this Parliament. Therefore,
Therefore, can the presiding officer assist me in understanding why the government is withholding statements from MSPs until the last minute? And does she believe this is good practice, as MSPs are restricted from being able to do their job for holding this government to account?
I thank Ms Gallagher for a point of order. I would say that, obviously, in terms of the guidance from the presiding officer, provision of statement in due time is very important and is a mark of the government showing courtesy and respect to individual members. Vis-à-vis the specifics of this case, I would advise Ms Gallagher that the presiding officer herself, who will be taking the chair for the next item of business, will address that issue further. Thank you.